and we surely
we do need the glory of the Lord. Amen. Amen. I thoroughly enjoyed myself thus far in this service to your wonderful pastor, Pastor Blackwell. Thank you for the opportunity to be here and this invitation. I've heard some of my favorite songs. Amen. All I got to do is live right and believe in what he says. Amen. I always wanted to sing the ladies' part, right?
All I have to do is live right.
Amen. I'm going to speak into the atmosphere. Amen. Amen. I'm going to speak in Jesus' will. I mean, this is some great stuff. Thank you so much again for the opportunity to be here. Without further ado, I know the young brother read it in 1 Timothy chapter 2, but I'll read it again in our hearing from the New American Standard Version. First of all, then I urge that entreaties and prayers, petitions and thanksgivings be made on behalf of all men for kings and all who are in authority, so that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God, and one mediator also between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony given at the proper time. For this I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I am telling the truth, I am not lying, as a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. The Lord has blessed his word. For the next few moments, friends, I will share with you from the subject, old head wisdom. Old head wisdom. Let us pray. Father God, more of you, less of us. Let these words be your words, that they may bless and encourage these, your people, to uplift us, to encourage us, to strengthen us, and give us courage in these days. This is our prayer, Lord. We ask it in faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, it's dangerous if you think you know everything. I've met far too many people that don't think they have anything to learn. They believe that they've made it to a certain plateau of life, and that has afforded them the opportunity to say that I don't need to learn anything. Matter of fact, you need to listen to me because I know everything that there is to know. It's dangerous when you think you know everything. In 1983, 456,000 Philadelphians went to the polls to vote in the mayor's election of that year, and it happened that they elected the first African-American mayor of the city of Philadelphia. In 2015, 126,000 went and voted in that last mayor election. In the span of 30 years, 300,000 eligible voters in this great city of Philadelphia decided to stay home and not to vote. I have to believe that there were some in 1983 that know some things that we simply have missed in 2015. I have to believe that there are some people that knew some things, that there is power in the ballot box as well as there's power in the house of God. I must believe that there are some folks who have led us astray and run us amok, that they tried to convince us of things that simply were not true, that we must find an old head.
Come on.
Who can lead the way. I have to be somewhere today around 2 o'clock, otherwise I might stay to hang out for lunch. Because as I look around this congregation, I believe there's one or two folks here that know how to cook. Oh, you know what I'm talking about. I've been in church a long time. And when there's a potluck supper or a lunch, everybody wants to bring everything, but there's always two or three that you know, and you praying on the night before, you say, I hope they bring that sweet potato pie on Sunday. I hope that they cook that chicken just right. Because you can't eat everybody's potato salad. Say amen. Beloved, there are lessons, there are ideals, there is wisdom, there is perspective, that we are able to learn and to glean from the generation that has come before. For they were once your age. I did not quite understand it, but as I grew up, every time I go to the barbershop, and at the barbershop, there are some things that are sacred in the barbershop. You don't talk about what happens in the barbershop when you leave the barbershop. But I grew up at the height of Michael Jordan. I remember when the first pair of Jordans came out. I remember how everybody stuck their tongue out at the basketball court. I remember going into the barbershop and saying Michael Jordan is the best player that ever lived. Without question, Pastor. There'd be an old brother over in the corner.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He'd say, young man, I know that that's all you've seen.
Yeah.
But when I grew up, there was a man named Whip the Stiff. And I know you saw Michael Jordan play, but see, I'm here to let you know the truth. And the truth is, the best basketball player that ever walked this earth was Whip the Stiff Chamberlain. I still remember 2008. I remember talking to those folks that raised me and that grew me up. And then they told me that they never thought they would see a president that looked like them.
Come on.
I remember the night when the returns came in. And I remember there was a feeling of pride. And those that were around me had tears in their eyes. And I began to say to myself, my, oh, my. And so I took their direction. And everywhere I went, I was promoting this understanding of this skinny black man from Chicago, Barack Hussein Obama, and I'll never forget it. A woman about 92 years old. She said, I'm glad that he's the president. But he wasn't the president when we were down on Columbia Avenue in the midst of the riots. I remember there was a man named Cecil B. Moore who led us on that night. For I tell you, in order for us to know where we are headed in the days to come, we must talk to those who have walked the road before we got here. It's dangerous. There are far too many folks that think that church started when they showed up. There are far too many people that say, you can't start until I get there. But there have been saints of the Lord who have marched into Zion for many a year. And if we are going to travail and traverse this year, 2018, then we must be able to talk to those who have traveled the road and learn from where they've been to inform where we are going. Young people, I tell you, you need some old head wisdom. We need to return to a time when we understood the joys and the importance of education. As I walk the streets in my neighborhood, whenever I see a young person out of school during the time that school ought to be in, I have made it my habit to ask them, why aren't you in school? Now, there's some reasons that I can do that. I can do that because I'm 6'3", 230 pounds. And I asked them with conviction in my voice, young man, young woman, why aren't you in school? There must be a return to understand that we weren't always allowed in the school. And now that we can go to school, there are those who have the nerve to say, I don't want to go to school. I'm tired. I want to stay in the bed. Tired from what? Staying up playing the game Halo. What's the new game now? I don't even know. Fortnite. You are blessed enough to say hallelujah that you got a TV. It was one TV in my house growing up. Say amen. And if you wanted to watch something, you had to wait until your mother was done watching what she wanted to watch. And when your father wanted to watch something, you had to wait until he was through. We must understand this importance of education, the preservation of the faith, and the witnessing of the church. We need some old head wisdom. That is what happens in the text that we read today. Paul and Timothy had met some years before. He had met during his second missionary journey. If you've ever read the book of Acts, Paul's missionary journeys were not ones that happen without any obstacles, without any failings, without any danger. I don't know, brothers and sisters, but some Christians today believe that this understanding of witnessing to one another, or this Christian life that we live, ought to be a life that never has any obstacles. But my Bible tells me that if you decide to say Jesus Christ is your Lord, if you believe that you will live a life holy and separate, and Paul decided to take this young man under his wing and to show him and to teach him and to raise him up in the faith. He wanted to serve as an example to Timothy. See, I'm not just going to look at the young people and make it hard on them. Half of the reason that our young people don't know is because we haven't shown them. See, nobody wants to talk about this understanding that says they know what we teach them. My young children say it all the time. We learn scriptures at the table. Right. And every Sunday they have to recite to me the scripture of the week. I can't be mad at them if they don't know any Bible. It's my responsibility to show them what's in the Bible. I tell you, Paul looked at Timothy and wanted to raise him up and to be an example to him. And he writes to Timothy at a difficult moment. All hell is breaking loose in Ephesus. Everyone's believing everything. No one will stand for truth and justice anymore. No one's going to the house of God. No one's going to see about the widows. No one is praying for those that are in a difficult situation. Nobody's going to the hospital room. Nobody is going to see about the homebound. Nobody is doing the things that we know we ought to do. All hell is breaking loose in Ephesus. I believe that there's one or two of us here today that understand this. That we understand in our great city of Philadelphia, it seems some days as if all hell is breaking loose. Night after night, moment after moment, we turn on the television, we read the newspaper, and we wonder to ourselves, what is going on? And then we hide behind closed doors, or rather the sacred doors of the church. I'm so encouraged to hear your pastor say that after church today, I hope you brought your walking shoes. Because if folks are coming in the doors, and we have a mandate from God to go out the doors in the times like these, what are we to do? We must encourage one another. In the faith. We must encourage one another in the faith. Young people, what I want you to see in the old head wisdom that Paul gave Timothy is when you find yourself at wit's end, when mental health is going crazy, when folks are bullying you online, when you feel the pressure of the generation, I want you to look to the scriptures, and the first thing I want you to do is pray. Everyone say pray.
Pray.
Take time to pray. Let's try that out. Take time to pray. Too many people are praying as if they're going through the drive-thru at McDonald's. My grandmother told me in the midst of Pontotoc, Mississippi, it takes time to serve the Lord. Look at what the Bible says first thing. I urge you that entreaties and prayers, petitions and thanksgiving be made on behalf of all people, all men, all women. This word entreaty speaks to the earnest and humble request. The petition means that we are making a formal request to the authority of God. And with thanksgiving, we are expressing gratitude, especially for God. And we have seen these same scriptures before. In Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6, it says the same thing. When you find yourself at wit's end in life, I don't care if you're 10 or 20, 30 or 40, 50 or 60, when you are up against the door, when the rubber meets the road and nobody in your circle can help you, that is when we turn to pray. Let me see if I can make it plain for a second. I don't want you just to pray in a babbling sense. The first thing I want you to do is I want you to give thanksgiving to God. Far too often we have been conditioned to look at those things that we do not have and forget all of the things that the Lord has already done. The song they taught us in Vacation Bible School 30 years ago, count your blessings. What he has done, then I want you to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Far too often, brothers and sisters, folks go to God as if he should answer you just because you're you. Woo! They think you are that Lord will answer you because you look so nice and your clothes are so fresh. Oh, the Lord ought to answer you because you shine your shoes and that you have got a new car. No, the Lord answers you because he gave you new life and promised to answer you. So when you come to the Lord, you better act like you know and humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. He woke me up this morning. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. He started me on my way. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Put food on my table. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God and started me on my way. Now after we thank the Lord for what he's already done, now that we've humbled ourselves under the mighty hand of God, then we can get around to asking the Lord for something. Lord, I know you've been good to me. Better than I could have been to myself. But I'm dealing with a situation right now. And nobody seems to help me. I looked all over. I couldn't find nobody. But then I looked to you, Lord, although all the answers are with you. You have the cattle of a thousand hills. You have all of the riches in glory. By Christ Jesus, you can do exactly what I'm asking you to. Brothers and sisters, I want us to take time. Take time to pray. We see it time and time again in 1 John chapter 5. This is the confidence that we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. We see it in Psalm 145 and verse 18. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. We see it again in 2 Chronicles 16, 11. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. Even the disciples needed some help in prayer. It's no shame that we have to learn and grow in our understanding of prayer. Only in the church do we never want to give anybody any grace. We want to give grace to the drug dealer. We want to give grace to the prostitute. We want to give grace to the dope boy. We want to give grace to everybody else, but let one person come to church. And then they say, I don't really know what to say. Then folks look at you strange. You don't know how to pray already? What you been doing all this time? Pastor Blackwell has been preaching all this time, and you still don't know how to pray. The disciples were with Jesus all the time, and they needed help in learning how to pray. You remember Luke 11, don't you? One of the disciples came to Jesus and said, Jesus, will you teach me? Will you teach me how to pray? And Jesus said, sure enough, I will. When you pray, just say, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. The old head used to say, now let us have a little talk with Jesus. wanted you to know. They said, let us. See, that means that all the time you don't just pray in your closet. Sometimes you got to get with some us. Sometimes you got to get with someone that's sitting next to you and behind you and around you. Sometimes you got to get on the prayer line on the telephone, or you got to get on your group chat on your phone. But sometimes you got to say, let us have a little talk with Jesus. I once was lost in sin, but Jesus, he took me in. And was a little light from heaven and filled my soul. He bathed my heart in love and wrote my name above. And just a little talk with Jesus makes me whole. I think y'all know the rest. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our struggle. He will hear our faintest cry, and he will answer by and by. Now this is my favorite part, Deacons. Now when you feel that little prayer will turn, y'all got to pass out tracks. Y'all got a whole lot of things to do. You see, it's a good thing you got a clock in the back, because a brother like me preached till the cows come on. I'm telling you right now. Old head wisdom, young people, says that when you find yourself in difficult spaces, turn to pray with those who care for you. The second thing I want you to realize is that it pleases God. Look at your Bibles. Look at verse 3. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires that all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. So why should we pray? Why should we give our lives unto God when we find ourselves in difficult spaces? Because it pleases God. Far too often we're trying to please the wrong people. We worrying about the wrong people and what they think about us. How many people have deferred their dreams because they were nervous about what somebody would say? How many young people have decided they're not going to go to college or technical school? They're not going to go into the service. They're nervous about what their friends are going to say. But sometimes you got to get some old head wisdom that says, never mind what they say. Worry about what God says. Because let me tell you something, and I've learned this in my growing up. I've learned that the folks doing the most talking are the folks that's never going to do anything. I've heard so many folks say, oh, what I'm about to do. But when it comes time to do it, they know where to be found. They want to say, well, I think the church ought to do this. But when it's time for the church to go out and fast track, they know where to be found. I think we ought to do this. But when it's time to put their money where their mouth is, they know where to be found. Their phone is off the hook. They're looking at caller ID. They don't want to hear from you. If you can't say amen, say oh me. It's the truth of God. We ought to look to please the Lord. Please God. In Proverbs 15 and verse 8, you'll read this. It says, the Lord detests the sacrifice of the wicked, but the prayer of the upright, that is what pleases him. The prayers of those who believe that God is and can still do exceedingly abundantly more than we can ask or think. Young brothers, let me tell you this right now. The God of 2018 is still the God of 1955. The God of 2018 is still the God of 1926. The God of 2018 is still the God that saw a generation out of slavery build institutions of higher learning with not much money in their pocket. The same God of 2018 is the God who's able to heal the sick and raise the dead. The same God is still able to work miracles and to change lives. The same God is able to do more than we can believe that God can do. I believe, Sister Jenkins, that God hasn't changed at all. I just believe we decided what God can and can't do. How many folks in your circle have decided what you can and can't do? Young ladies, how many people in your circle have decided what job is good for you and what's not? Young men, how many people in your circle have decided what profession you can have? Some of us need to tighten up that circle. Don't worry about how many friends you got on Facebook, because everybody that says they for you is not for you. Because if they will talk to you about somebody else, they will talk to somebody else about you. I didn't come up with that myself. My cousin Lee told me that when I was about 12. I tell you, we need some old head. Some old head wisdom. When it's time to pray, we pray. And then as we pray, we realize that it pleases God. And it comes down to this, beloved. What the scripture says right here, that God wants all to come to salvation. Look at verse 5. For there is one law. And one mediator also between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony given at a proper time. Paul told Timothy, while you're there in Ephesus, Timothy, don't worry about what's happening. I just want you to pray. And realize that your prayer are pleasing to God, and because they are pleasing to God, I want you to realize that God wants everybody to be saved. For we all have a shared history. Everyone say shared history.
Shared.
See, that's half the problem all the, in the days that we live in, is everybody wants to be special. Everybody wants to look at themselves and say, well, I'm different than you. Well, I don't care if you come to church on Saturday or Sunday, Tuesday or Wednesday. We have a shared history. I don't care if you're from Germantown or Jamaica. I don't care if you're from Southwest or you're from the same Swahili. You speak Swahili. I don't care if you're from Canada. I don't care if you're from all the lands of all the world. We have a shared history.
Yes.
And what is the shared history, beloved? That there is one man who decided that he was going to go to the cross for both yes. you and I. What is the shared yes. history? That Jesus, they hung him high and they stretched him wide. Yes. He hung his head and then he died. What is the shared history? That blood and water came out of his side. What is the shared history? That whether you are man or woman, boy or girl, yes. salvation is still free for you. What is the history that the God who causes the sun to rise, and the God who causes the sun to set, the God who brings the moon to the sky, and the God who has named every star name by name, the God who causes the corn to grow, and the God who causes the waters to run, the God who calls us to be right now, is the same God who is with you in good times and bad.
Yes.
He's the same God that's with you when you got to study or not. He's the same God that's with you when you don't think you'll make it to the end. He is the same God.
Amen.
So we will not worry. We will not be dismayed. No matter what comes against us in these days of living. No matter what they say about us, no matter what 45 wants to do to us, I don't care who the president is, I know who sits on the throne. I don't care who's in the Congress, I know who sits high and looks low. I know when he got up out of the grave and said that Jesus had all power in his hand. And when you have all power, that means you can do all things. When you have all power, you can break the addiction of drugs and alcohol. When you have all power, you can make the A's in the school. When you have all power, you can do all manner of greatness. For God, God is the same. Same God. He's the same yesterday. He's the same today. He's the same forever. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
there's someone that wants to come to Jesus today, I invite you to come. The pastor or the elders, the deacons, they'll meet you here. Salvation is still free. It says, I was a rancher, yes, living in a world. I had no hope, I had no peace within. But somebody told me.
And now I'm justified. I'm sanctified.